So it's been a lot of time since Salazar, since
colonial war Portugal.
What's good now? What's great about Lisbon?
The country's going through this crisis, but at the same time, everybody's valuing the nice things that we have.
A lot of museums, a lot of theater.
A lot of music. Some of the most incredible coastline, seafood, history, architecture.
Such a sense of community.
Every time I walk around, it's like, oh, something to discover.
You see many layers of time.
What other major capitals look like this? None. You haven't f***ed it up. Oof. Looking forward to this.
I'm Anthony Bourdain.
That's right.
I write, I travel, I eat, and I'm hungry for more.
I've been to Portugal before, the north, to the Azores, and I've been to much of the former Portuguese Empire, Brazil, Macau, Mozambique. But I'd never been to Lisbon. It's an old city, the heart of the Age of Discovery, once the world's richest empire. There's history here, lots of it.
We have much to offer in terms of tourism, like good weather, good food. You have mountains, you have sea.
It's a beautiful city. They don't make cities like this. You know, I took the tram here. I mean, this is ridiculous. Who does this? You know, this old thing going through the pits. It's awesome.
I think the people are nice. What do you think?
I think so, too.
Lisboetas, as the locals are known, like their food. They talk about it a lot and have strong ideas about what visitors should eat and where.
We have chorizo, meat sausage.
Squid, octopus.
We have musel, it's like a blood sausage.
I love blood sausage, it's one of my favorite things on earth.
But I think the big thing about Portugal is the seafood.
Oramiro is one of those places that locals love, have always loved, and always will love.
This is a local place, anywhere from top-end businessmen to regular people.
Here we call cervejaria.
Cervejaria.
Chef-friendly, the kind of straight-ahead meals that chefs tired of sauce and garnish crave.
I can guarantee you, if you ask 10 chefs in Lisbon, 20 chefs in Lisbon, where would they like to go, they come here.
Chefs like José Avilés and Henrique Sopsoa.
We start with seafood and we finish with a prego. It's a steak sandwich.
That's the tradition?
That's a tradition.
Start with the seafood, end with the steak sandwich.
And that's what they call here the dessert. And for dessert, you have a steak sandwich.
These guys have been at the forefront of a new move towards modernizing traditional Portuguese cuisine. But like me, they still love the good old stuff.
Beautiful. Thanks.
Goose barnacles.
Just squeeze and suck them right on.
Yeah.
Shrimps to die for.
Sweet.
Langoustine that'll make you cry.
Wow, those are pretty.
Tiny, almost sweet little clams.
To me, the Portuguese do clams better than anyone in the world.
A barrage of minimalist seafood of maximum quality.
These are great. These are really, really awesome.
Fat of crab.
This, the fat and the roe all mashed up.
Together.
Oh, yeah.
Scarlet shrimp.
Wow, look at that thing. Everything I love in life, this is it right here.
Good luck for you, okay?
Thank you. I don't like how he said that.
We won't need
good luck. Wow, those are good.
My God.
Oh, yeah.
You taste it, it's like explosion of the sea.
Oh.
This is heaven.
Man. They're very straight ahead. They don't do a lot to their fish here.
Only cook it, and then you have some seasonings. Garlic, cilantro. So you don't need many spices or fats here. This is all about
this. No, squeeze all the shrimp brains out and stuff. It's like the best sauce.
A lot of people find gross, but...
Basically, if you don't like what's inside a shrimp head, I can't be like your friend.
Even me.
Wow, this is just incredible. You guys have got it good.
Okay, we have to say, not everyone is doing this every day in Portugal.
Okay.
So people don't think like... Today.
Every day, most of the population wake up for a giant piece of seafood exactly like this. Part of the daily diet of your average Portuguese. What do you think the future of Portuguese gastronomy is going to be? I mean, the big question is the money here?
Yeah. Because let's face it, we are a country that economically is going to live off tourism.
This food in another country of Europe,
you
cannot afford that.
No way.
What we're having here anywhere else, if you go to London, you go to Paris, you go to Rome, we would be paying $300-$400.
That prawn would be 50 euros.
Just for the prawn.
Easy, just for the one.
Yeah.
That was incredible.
You ready for dessert?
Ready for dessert.
For dessert, and you gotta have dessert, right? Prego.
Lots of garlic and meat.
Awesome.
A steak sandwich slash booze mop.
There's certain American dishes, it's like you want the nasty mustard.
Yeah, that's a nasty mustard.
That puts you right over the edge in a protein overdose. Which is to say, happiness.
Yeah, I get it. You're really drunk. You need this.
Yeah, because seafood was just, we're not going to be able to.
After too many beers.
10 or 10, 15 right. beers. This is not the place where you bring your girlfriend to eat.
No.
Awesome. Loucura genão, meu coração.
You could say that fado is Lisbon's answer to the blues, but it's more than that. At any of scores of bars like this, professionals and amateurs alike stand and take their turn, singing heartfelt songs of separation, loss, yearning, and love gone wrong. It embodies the Portuguese propensity for nostalgia, an ache for the past, saudade. But for many, the past is too painful.
This music was closely associated for many years with the Salazar regime. You don't really like fado music.
People use it to say that the dictatorship had three things: football, fado, and Fatima. When the revolution came, fado was...
For Portugal's greatest living writer, Antonio Lobo Antunes, fado is the soundtrack to bad times. You can hardly blame him. For decades, Antonio Salazar ruled with an iron fist and jackboot. There were colonial wars, a republic of fear.
Before the revolution, for example, once I asked my father, Father, what's democracy? And he said, shut up and eat. Because you never know who was going to telephone or write a politic policy. You couldn't talk politics, you couldn't kiss a girl in the street, you couldn't do anything. Anything. And the price of heroin, the heroin was cheaper than cigarettes.
Why?
Because if you were, you wouldn't fight the dictatorship.
Tempo perdido, tenta esquecer, tira o sentido dessa mulher. Loucuras não.
Lobo Antunes served as a medic during Portugal's brutal colonial war in Angola in the early 70s.
Everything changed for me in the war. The soldiers, they were so brave, so incredibly brave. They were very poor. One of them told me, you know, since I'm in the army, it's the first time I have shoes. They're very, very poor. It was horrible because the political police was in Africa too, making horrible things.
Even now, 40 years later, notice how he drops his voice and covers his mouth when he speaks.
I must give the readers not the book they want, the book they don't want.
As if someone might be listening.
I had some problems 2 years ago because I talked about that cruelty and things they did, and napalm and everything, which still now is denied.
Still. People don't want to be reminded about the past, especially if it's a guilty or unattractive past.
Everywhere, that same thing everywhere. In Spain, they don't talk about civil war.
Twenty-seven-year-old Carminho is one of a new generation of fado singers. With the number one hit and shows sold out all over Europe, you can hardly associate her with the dictatorship in the old days. And it's beautiful. But for Lobo Antunes, you can never forget. He can barely bring himself to watch. Hell, I can understand where he's coming from, but I liked it.
About someone who wrote their lover's name in the wind, to the wind,
spread
the name away. She thought that putting his name in the wind
would help her forget.
Help her, but was the opposite, because the wind is everywhere, so his name is everywhere.
Fado music. These are very sentimental songs. They're about longing, displacement, heartbreak, yearning. These are things I hear a lot. In Lisbon. Why does it speak to the Portuguese soul?
Many Portuguese, they still live in an illusory past, you know, the conquests, navigators, and so on.
We are a very old country with a lot of wars and sailors going, discovering the world, brides waiting, mothers crying. I think that maybe can stay in the blood.
Many, many years in the authorship, there was no future. There was a very teeny present and the enormous past, the dictatorship. Now with the economical crisis, young people, they don't have no future, no money, no jobs, nothing. They go to universities and their hope is to earn 1,000 euros or less.
So why is this a good place to live? Brazilians, no matter how poor, you know, while they're being beaten by the police in a favela, they're going to, you know, if you ask them, what do you think about your country? Brazil, number one. They're going to tell you, Brazil, best country in the world. I'm not getting that here.
Sometimes I wonder if Portugal is not what the sea doesn't want.
Portuguese people are not so positive.
You've noticed.
In a crisis, sometimes we have an opportunity. I think we just have to keep the hope.
Are we there yet?
Oh no, another fishing scene. You know that's what I'm thinking, right? But out there, near where the Teju River empties into the Atlantic, from where the old empire launched Vasco da Gama and 1,000 ships to circle the globe, that's where the octopus is. And that's what I'll be having for lunch with Chef José Aviles and fisherman Carlos and his wife, Carla.
These boats to fish 40,000 euros. It's very expensive for them to maintain.
Not a lot of work out there these days in a worldwide financial crisis that's hitting Portugal particularly hard. This is one way to carve out something of a living.
It's ready, the fishing.
Pray to God we get some here, man. Because if it's out there rougher, way to cough up my breakfast.
You need to
keep it moving.
Moving.
Right above the bottom?
Right.
On the bottom. It's a lot like squid fishing, yes?
Yes. This going to the sea is too small.
I would eat them.
I think they're going.
They're saying there's nothing here.
No.
2 weeks ago, they were catching like 200 kilos a day of octopus. But not today, for sure.
Tony, you want?
Not right now, no. Huh? You guys enjoy yourself.
Is this Shambhala I want?
It's cold. And I did not, it turns out, wear sensible footwear for a leaky boat.
Too late, dude. Can't feel my legs. Just sat on a mackerel.
One more small.
Stunt octopus?
Hey!
Yeah, look promising.
Yeah, it's the best.
That's big enough.
Sharp knife to the brain, and faster than a high-concept travel show that didn't have good first-week numbers, our catch is given a swift and merciful end. Refreshment, perhaps. Cold, cold beer.
So boil first. For how long?
20 minutes, 40 minutes.
40 minutes and then?
40 minutes. Then grill.
It's nice. Cheers.
Yeah, good, man. Yeah, tender.
Cambia muito.
E eu, empregada de andar, empregada de andar, sou pescadora.
She used to work in auto. Mm-hmm. And he used to work in the metro, mm-hmm. driving the metro. And he, in 81, they come back here to fish.
Hard way to make a living.
Very hard.
Hope it's fun. So what's out there? There's sardines, there's mackerel, octopus, squid, cuttlefish?
Yeah.
But, you know, value of fish changes like that.
Yeah.
20 years ago, squid was super cheap. Trash fish. Octopus, they throw it back.
São servidas?
Obrigada.
Gosto desse aqui ao pé da gente.
Fishing, is it getting harder every year, or does it have good years and bad years?
Não, a pesca é cada vez mais difícil.
It's harder every year.
I mean, generally speaking, what everybody complains about is fewer fish,
yeah.
More expensive gas.
Here is the same. It's the same here.
Now they're selling fish cheaper than 10 years ago.
Cheaper?
Cheap. They sell the sardine 20 cents sometimes, and in the market it's 5 euros.
Who's making the money?
The EU eats, it's not so good for this kind of fish.
The EU. Who's it good for? I mean, EU is good for me because I don't like going through border controls, so that's easy.
That's easy.
I like using the same money, but who else is it good for? I mean, it's not good for Germany, it's not good for Greece. Who's it good for?
Very bad.
Possible, I like to eat where I can also fill all my fishing tackle needs. Sol and Pesca, in the crummy part of town. A strip populated by cruiserweight hookers with bad dentistry.
And I could buy a rod here if I wanted to?
I think so.
But you guys not fishing?
No.
So what do you come here for?
To drink.
Along with my love of fishing tackle, I've recently acquired a true and deep love for really good stuff.
Eels, sardine.
That comes in cans. Really?
It's a mushama. Smoked tuna fish.
Ooh, it's like tuna jerky.
Yeah.
Classic.
Is this sort of like the regular musician's diet?
Yeah. Poor musicians.
I'm eating these guys. Pedro Gonzalves and Toe Treeps, known as Dead Combo, one of the best and most interesting bands in Lisbon. You may know their music from such shows as this one.
How is the music business in Lisbon right now? I mean,
it's getting better, but it's difficult to make a living out of it. It's a small country. There's not that much money, so people don't buy that many records to get to the top.
Yes.
20 if you sell in a week 250 records.
Yeah, well, this is a good investment.
Yeah,
you buy 250 records.
You buy it yourself.
Yeah,
I know people who have done it.
And you know people who've done it. All right, what else do we have in cans that's good?
Portuguese sardines served on Portuguese bread.
Mmm, that's amazing.
Au vegetal, tuna roast.
Nice.
Tuna roast served with sweet potatoes and horse mackerel. That oil, by the way, is pure gold.
Mm. That's good. That's like total crack. Oh, man. Also amazing. But I gotta ask you, do you have hipsters here? Like, do you have these people walking around with socks on their head? Like Brad Pitt, you know, they look like Smurfs. They got a sock on their head.
And fortunately, we have very few.
Very few. Yeah. You really gotta stop that. Sockheads. I hate them. So what's the best trend that music in Lisbon is going?
Well, in the 80s, there was a lot of like rock bands incorporating Portuguese influences into the music. And then suddenly in the 90s, Portuguese music like, you know, completely died. And now it's like coming back.
Like some of the chefs we're going to meet, Dead Combo is taking the old and making it new.
The country is going through this crisis, but at the same time, everybody's valuing the nice things that we have, like the food, the music, this, yeah, like this place, for example.
That's important to you.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, very important.
Everybody says the same thing when you tell them you're going to Lisbon. One thing you gotta do if you're gonna do it like a local. A low-rent favorite, a guilty pleasure, an early morning buzz. Call it what you like.
Let's go.
A ginginha, a joint selling a drink of the same name. A hole in the wall surrounded by layabouts and characters.
These people look like serious drinkers.
Ginginha, a liqueur made from Morello cherries. They've been selling this stuff for 70 years. Same spot, same recipe.
Oh yeah, I'll have one of those.
Only option, with a cherry or without. And watch out, it goes down smooth.
That'll straighten your out good.
But packs a vicious punch.
I'm gonna have to have another one of those. Yeah. Mm. Excellent, merci. That's some good. Ooh. There's some alcohol in that last cherry somewhere. Cancel the meal scene. I'm going down.
Pleasantly drunk and stupid enough to consider that endorsement deal from Antabuse, I stagger into the street, only dimly aware that I've got a big lunch ahead of me.
What will this city look like in 20 years? Because good sense would dictate, fill the place with ugly buildings, make it more functional, make it more like everybody else.
You won't go that way.
You didn't even have to think about that.
There's a conservative side to the Portuguese soul. You can still find the same Lisbon, the same cobbled streets, the same trams going around.
And the food?
There's a generation, like, because these young chefs are keeping the tradition, but they're thinking ahead.
José Avilés is one of a few chefs in Lisbon exploring new ways of looking at traditional dishes. He's worked with some of the world's great chefs and brought what he learned and was exposed to abroad back home to Continho do Avilés.
My good friend José that met me when I was like 4 years old.
José Brito is a legendary music producer, composer, musician, and raconteur. He still recalls the time when artistic expression was censored by Salazar's police state.
I was in the top band in Portugal in those days. Because we had kind of political history and being against the regime. We had a lot of records that were forbidden by the political police, they were taken off the shops. And I decided there was no way they were going to get me in the army fighting a war that I didn't have anything to do.
So what did you do?
I deserted. I just said, I'm going. And I went to England until the revolution came and I came back.
Oh, that looks good. What's that?
Some green beans in tempura. This is very typical Portuguese appetizer.
Portugal invented tempura. Mm-hmm. Japanese have a lot to thank you for. This is one of my favorite things in the world.
Musella, blood sausage, something I always like. This one, particularly good.
This is a typical blood sausage, but with rice. This one is very typical from the north of Portugal.
Beautiful. Love it. Oh, that looks good.
Pig trotters.
Oh, nice.
With cilantro, coriander.
Pig trotters, or feet, classic peasant food, and a perfect blend of textures. Meaty, crispy, fatty, sticky.
There was a time that there was no way we could throw it away, you know? We had to invent dishes with all of that.
So how traditional are these dishes?
Very traditional in Portugal.
I mean, these are pretty refined versions of these.
It's a refined version of that.
People really hang on to those flavors ferociously here.
People still go for the basics, you know?
Something old, something new.
My interpretation of a golden egg with seps and cheese.
Nice.
And dessert.
Oh, hazelnut ice cream, hazelnut whipped cream, and hazelnuts. Nice. Mmm.
The country has been poor for decades and decades and decades, you know. And it's, at the moment, it's again going through a crisis, a huge crisis. Portugal is actually almost desertified in the interior, you know. It's nobody living there. It's amazing how beautiful it is and the potential the country's got. Nobody's there.
No one's there. Why?
Because apart from agricultural life, there's nothing much you can do there.
But not because of EU regulations?
Beginning of the 80s, the money started pouring from the European community, saying, okay, agriculturally, you're going to stop producing oranges or tomatoes or olives or whatever because the Italians are doing it, the French are doing it, the potatoes.
So they're paying you not to grow things or fish?
Absolutely. They paid us to stop producing what we've been doing for centuries. And suddenly, there was no production and there was no industry.
Well, let's get this straight. Well, wine you have is great.
The wine's unbelievable.
Cheese, awesome.
Cheese, brilliant.
Olive oil. Olives, seafood, some of the best in the world.
Seafood. Just for internal consumption because we don't have enough to export.
But you could. Great meal. True to your roots.
It's good.
It's really nice.
Around 30 euros.
No.
That's good news.
It's crazy.
I'll drink to that.
Horseshoes and hand grenades, together, sort of, in one game.
Chinquillo.
Chinquillo.
Chinquillo, last bastion of a traditional game. Mostly for old dudes these days.
How many people in this club?
100.
100?
Well, yeah, 100.
So it's pretty popular.
It's popular.
What does the winner get? Is there money involved?
No.
There's no gambling on this game?
Only for both of the wine, nothing more.
Wine.
I'm here with another chef who's been making a lot of noise in Lisbon. Yugoslavian transplant, Lubomir Stanisic. I've heard he's got a competitive streak, but can he play this game?
These things look heavy.
What?
Are they heavy? But...
A little bit.
A little bit.
3 kilos?
3-4 kilos.
But...
It's monstrous.
Into the Chinquillo court. Like Thunderdome, only not really.
Okay, you choose your dish.
These metal plates weigh about 7 pounds each. Not for the weak. But Senor Sosa here, pushing 80, is a pro. He slings these things around like tiddlywinks. Huh? How hard could it be?
Wait a minute. Heavy.
Answer? Pretty hard.
Holy crap.
3 points for knocking over the peg. First one to 25 wins. Lubo and I choose teams.
Okay, you choose your two players. You ready?
Let's do it.
Good choice for your player.
So what do you think? It's challenging, no?
Yeah, it's hard.
As I like to say around the office, old age and corruption beats youth and beauty every time.
Oh, man. Oh. God, that guy's good. Closing in on that, I'm telling you. See, that was all. Sorry, Pops. I must have gotten confused.
Tied up at 24, no thanks to me.
It's a nail biter, folks.
Next team to score wins.
It's a lot of pressure.
Take your time.
Damn.
Will I leave this game without a single point? Not to put too much pressure on you, but this could bring victory to your team. I'm going to practice, and I'll be back to build a little court in my backyard.
At his restaurant, Semanarish, or 100 Ways, Lubo brings his Yugoslavian roots to bear on traditional Portuguese dishes.
This is going to be good. Ask them if they're hungry.
Don't go farming.
They better be. This is a game I can win.
I brought along the kids from the Chinquillo to find out just how open to a new look at these traditional dishes they might be.
All right.
They look like completely weirded out.
Monica is Lubo's wife.
What is it?
Codfish tripe.
Mmm. Oh, that's tasty.
Let's have a try.
Cod tripe. Dried, then deep fried till crispy delicious. The clothesline, similar to something I've seen at Alinea in Chicago.
We are joking because this is normally the intimate parts of the clothes.
Underpants.
Yeah, underpants. These are game pie with truffles and Saint-Georges cheese.
This is a pastry.
Yeah.
And inside is game.
Game, yeah.
What? Which game?
Rabbit.
Oh, nice. Very Portuguese, very yes. Typical. How do you say rabbit in Portuguese?
Coelho.
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 Coelho. Oh, don't forget it.
While I may not be familiar with the Portuguese pronunciation, in my language, it's...
Mmm. Delicious.
I love this one.
Whoa, what's that?
Horse.
Horse.
Heart.
Heart.
Bull liver.
Bull, right.
And pork brain.
Is this traditional?
This is very traditional.
Very.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah?
So young customers totally like this?
No. This?
No, no. Young ones, no. The horse thing, you know, yeah. You start to run in at like, oh, the poor horsey.
We had a part of the sex of the bull. I don't know how to call it.
Testicles.
Testicles, thank you. We have to put it like bullfight meat.
Right.
You know? People didn't know what it was, and they loved it.
See? Oh, yeah.
And then he said, shocked. But all Portuguese
they like
men,
it.
Oof, it's like, wow. You know?
Mmm. Very good.
It's very delicate. Delicate, yeah. Like the testicles.
Oh, oh, that looks good.
This is very traditional.
Yeah, he's happy about this.
Cabrito. Who would not love this? Young, milk-fed goat, roasted and served on rice made with its liver, and a magical stock made from tongue, mushroom, and chicken.
Wow, it's awesome looking. That's shockingly good. Oh, yeah.
This is one of the most requested dishes. Young, old, everyone. I like it a lot.
You satisfied a very tough demographic here. These ornery old dudes, they were tough.
Bit cooler last couple days.
That's nice. Compared to New York, this is tropical.
Want to get the lay of the land, so to speak? Find out what's good in a new city? Find the local market.
Wow.
So this is the old market.
This is a retail market for regular people to shop in.
Yeah.
And if possible, bring a chef along.
It's interesting.
Yeah, that's black swordfish. It's got a lot of bones. It's not an easy fish to eat.
Like Enrique Sapsola.
Cod tongues, which is another delicacy of here.
Host of his own weekly cooking show.
Bon dia, tudo bem? Normally, they open up at 6, which is where all the fish come in. And then they go up until 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and then that's it. But you see more older people.
Right, that's the way they used to buy.
Yeah. The good thing about these markets is that you can still interact with the actual suppliers. You have a bigger connection with the product, because they know what they're selling.
Right. Right, a supermarket, they have no idea where it came from
already. Supermarket, you're just buying a pack of things, and you don't know exactly what's going on.
Yeah, but this is sort of a disappearing, as more and more moving towards a supermarket model.
Unfortunately.
Local fish.
Oh, you got a big
swordfish there. Wow.
What is that?
Schiedinger top in the boca, which is hake with a tail in their mouth.
Sausage, cheese.
Holy crap. Let's, I want to see these.
An impressive variety of produce.
Staple Portuguese vegetables. Cabbage, kale, of course.
Tomatoes, sweet potato, turnip tops. Normally, in a lot of countries, they chuck this out.
Right. A little bitter?
Very bitter.
Sounds good. Yeah. I like bitter.
Then obviously, cod.
Gotta have that.
Gotta have the cod.
The national dish of Portugal? Probably bacalhau. Salted, dried codfish. Strangely enough, neither the fish nor the product is indigenous to Portugal. But they eat a lot of it and love it dearly. Before cooking, you soak it in water and rehydrate it.
In restaurants, you have to buy your cod already pre-soaked.
You can't buy it like that.
This is only for house consumption.
That's an EU thing. What was their thinking? I mean, there's nothing left alive in a piece of dried salted fish. Yeah. What's the problem?
The chefs were really pissed off.
Oh, that's like heartbreaking.
Example. I know. Now I'm using a lot of the cheaper fishes, like mackerel, sardines, fishes that fishermen used to throw out in the sea.
Trash fish.
Yeah, because I think they're full of flavor, and I can make dishes that are more affordable to sell.
You know, I think everybody's kind of headed in that direction.
Yeah.
Oh, that looks good.
Now I'm at Alma. Enrique's place, where he starts me off with the cheap but delicious mackerel.
This is nice.
It's great.
A young city or an old city? I mean, population-wise. Because it's famous for clubs and music scene.
There's that blend between the old and the new, which is nice. You'll find a lot of old people still living in houses next to younger people, really young people, because that's the new trendy places.
Right.
With me is actor and comedian Zé Diogo Quintela.
What's funny to people in Lisbon?
Right now, there's a lot of fun we have with the crisis and...
So you, laughing at your own pain.
Yeah, that's universal, I think.
I don't know that the French and Italians do that so much. The comedy's mostly jokes.
They do a lot of those, and
I mean, that's funny everywhere.
Yeah.
It's worked for me for 7 years, let me tell you.
But there's one thing you can't joke about in Portugal. Make fun of somebody's soccer club.
Even I know not to do that. Oh, that looks good.
It's the baby pork with sweet potato puree and bok choy.
Look at that. Mm. Whoa.
Now we have the semi-salted cod with chickpea puree.
Beautiful.
At last, bacalhau. Some say there are more than 365 ways to cook this stuff, one for every day of the year. Others say more. Whatever the number, this ingredient is integral to the Portuguese table.
Funny thing is that this is the most traditional dish in Portugal, and we don't have them in our waters.
Right.
We went after our national food.
Yeah. Mm, that's good.
I love it.
So, obviously, you weren't around during Salazar days.
I wasn't.
Right. So, if you're young and 22 in Lisbon, is life good?
It's hard to get a job and to keep one. Mm-hmm. But if you can get a job that can support you, life is peachy. The other day I heard someone say in the news, we are the only country that hosted a G20 meeting. There were no riots in the street. There were no windows smashed, and not like in Greece.
They're not like Greece.
That's one thing that our politicians keep saying to everybody in Europe. We're not like the Greeks. We're going to pay up. We're going to pay up. Please lend us the money.
There's always something people need when they say I've had a few cocktails. You know, it's late in the day, and maybe you had a little more to drink than might have been advisable. And you need to eat something to soak it all up, make you feel better about yourself.
Bifana? Beer?
In Lisbon, that magical dish is something called a bifana.
Yes. Give me your hot porky love.
A much-loved cure-all in the form of a pork sandwich. Greasy pork, the greasier the better, low-rent mustard, a touch of chili oil, and a bun. Oh yeah, and a cold beer.
Totally awesome.
Somehow, I knew all along that we would meet in the end. Now, finally, we are together. That's good.
Why is it so often it all comes down to this? Pork on a piece of bread. Perfection, really. I could do another one of those. Easy.
Can I stand the shame and self-loathing?
Yes, yes, I think I can.
That was awesome.